Homely Planet.
You're listening to the Dimensions Project from Priory College,
a global education skills project developed and managed by Beyond Skins in partnership with Concern Worldwide.
Funded by the Department of International Development.
For more information about the project, visit www.beyondskinsglobal.org.
So I'm going to give you a page, and what I want you to do is to write a list of 8 things that you think are basic to live. What do you need to live, okay? Only 8.
Number 1, football.
Not football.
You have to have football alone. David.
Need food, you need shelter. So you need food, you need shelter.
Your name is no. PC close.
Food.
Football.
Shelter.
Shelter. Not really.
You need a house. Of some sort too.
You need heat.
You need heat.
You don't, you just put on an extra jumper.
Shelter.
Heat. You need heat.
You need heat.
How do you think people...
You put on another jumper because you
need
heat.
How do you think people reacted about 25 million years ago? They just use extra jumpers or extra fur.
That's because they're cold, they're putting more jumpers on for heat.
So you don't, you need clothes?
You do need heat if you're cold.
Heat. You need...
Because clothes give you heat.
Water.
Wow, you need water, that's one.
Jeez, you need water.
Food comes on the right water, whatever.
Bells.
Exercise, you need exercise because you get really fat, you'll die. What do you want? What, money?
Money.
I'll just write money to help.
Education.
Education. No.
No, I won't mention that.
Not mention that.
3-4-0. Don't need football.
You do.
Football, okay. You don't need football, but that actually.
You need sport.
Sport? Or recreation?
Sport.
Recreation. It's food and water. Interactive services.
Lots of phone.
Yeah, but that's phone, laptop, computer.
Technology?
Barbecue sauce.
House? Hi, shelter, yeah.
Family, friends, we'll put friends up here.
Contact lenses, yeah.
Medic.
So health services or something?
To be honest, I think you need money first.
You also need clothes too.
You can't buy food without money.
No, don't do clothes as one of the top
But
ones.
You can, because you can go out and catch something.
Friends,
those two need to be next. You don't need money to catch something.
You're not going to die if you connect.
You don't really need education, like. You don't really need education.
Josh, you need education. Wise up.
You don't need education.
Wise up, Josh. You need education.
To live, you don't need education.
You do.
To live.
You do. Wise up.
Right, our first one is clothes, and then our second one's food, and then water, and then Sarah said technology, and then shelter, and education, drugs.
You mean medicine?
Yeah. Yes, medicines, and social...
Contact?
Social contacts, like friends and family. That's our 8.
And what are your 8?
We wrote oxygen to breathe. Food, clothes, heat, water, shelter, family, and love.
Okay, great.
We had food, water, shelter, heat, money, friends and family, and then education and clothes.
I want you to read the Millennium Goals, please.
Reduce poverty. Educate every child. Equal chances for girls and women. Reduce the number of babies and children who die. Ensure safe and healthy motherhood. Clean up the environment. Fight infectious diseases. And share responsibility for making the world a better place.
Okay.
change the world in 3 steps.
Yes, 8 steps.
Okay, fine, 8 steps.
Reduce poverty.
Educate every child. Equal chances for girls and women. Reduce the number of babies and children who die. Ensure safe and healthy motherhood. Fight injection diseases, infections. Clean up the environment and share responsibility for making the world a better place.
Reduce the number of babies.
Yes, oxygen.
Don't know what is it, clean up the environment?
Yeah.
The ensure healthy motherhood, which is good for under family.
And if you have food, then it can reduce the number of babies.
I'll pick the first one, which is poverty.
No.
Then
food and water and education. Shelter.
No, education.
Health. Health and
drugs.
Well-being.
Drugs.
Drugs, right.
Water, food.
So that's number shelter. 4.
So water, food, 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 shelter, and clothes.
Four. Technology.
Yeah,
recycling tools, or yeah.
What should we should pick?
Technology.
Yes, communication. And also.
Education.
Well, the poverty, poverty is as bad as what it is, only in this country, as far as I'm
but
concerned.
But the clean up yes. The environment affects everyone.
The environment isn't even that bad, to be quite fair.
It is.
Does all the streets look like that?
Yeah.
That's because it's being our streets are being cleaned and pushed onto someone else's.
As well. Yeah, but like
yeah, putting there putting
that's like
chemicals into the air.
Fight infectious diseases. That's what's happening now. They're doing this.
Educate every child, will that be love in a way?
Yeah,
mm-hmm. Yeah, because if you love the thing you want is to have a good education.
Yeah.
Is poverty not where somebody is getting mistreated?
No.
Well, what is poverty?
Poverty's not being able to get clean water.
It's just
not being able to clean yourself and eat properly.
Proper house.
Yeah, drink.
Knowing where your next meal is coming from.
Can't buy enough money to buy a phone card. You know?
Say, someone would think poverty being here is like
for the whole
not having electricity to charge your
phone. For the whole of the UK.
Like camping or something.
Exactly. For the whole of the UK. If you were to check stats for poverty, we know.
And send your friends.
If you were to check poverty rates for the likes of India, Africa, it'd be high compared to what it would be here.
Yeah.
So if your government isn't stable, basically your laws, etc. with all this here stuff isn't going to be stable. And ours at the moment is stable, which is why some of these issues aren't as serious as what it would be in other countries.
For all these things to be perfect, you need a government.
Basically.
Because in China they're saying you're allowed one child per family now because they were overrun.
They're overpopulated basically.
So that's their government's way of cutting down population.
Yep.
So do you think that it is right to try and help people who have less, like to try and improve in the
we're talking about different countries.
Oh well even in general, if you were an alcoholic and it was your fault,
say,
to know.
Say you're born in somewhere like Africa.
You might not have the money to buy alcohol.
You might not have the circumstances. Stuff to even live or like fresh water, we take that for granted here. But someone living there would think that's a gift.
That's poverty.
I don't know.
Yes, that's
so technically, water.
Water would be one, yes.
Yeah.
Well then, if you're saying water, then I suppose shelter's gonna have to be one then too.
Action against infections, diseases.
Okay. Yeah.
Well, one of them it says to ensure safe and a healthy motherhood. So to have ensure and safe motherhood, you need to have a shelter so you can feel secure, basically.
Okay.
So we had shelter, so we thought that would be a good one. We also said education, and it says educate every child. So ours linked in to that one. And
poverty and hunger.
Oh yeah, the poverty and hunger one was linked in with our food one.
The water, because people don't have clean water.
Okay. Poverty. So it's like sanitation, no?
Yeah.
We also had for a spare one. We also had book government written down for a spare. And if you don't really have a stable government, you really won't have a lot of this happening.
Good.
Which include.
Well done.
On our list, we have, well, education would be lined up with everything because to reduce poverty, you need to educate people about it and tell them about it and, like, okay. In school and stuff. And for, like, six, fight infectious diseases, you need to educate people about them diseases and how to stop them or how to treat them. And that's the next thing. All of them link in with education because to ensure safe and healthy motherhood, you need to tell people about it. And then our other ones are for water, reduce poverty, and reduce the number of babies and children who die because they need water on so they don't die, and food, and clothes, them three, so they don't die, and shelter as well. And then for cleaning up the environment, you're going to need technology like diggers and stuff.
Okay.
And machines to take the rubbish away.
Okay, very good point. Did you find easy to match the two lists?
Well, the kind of everything matches in with everything in some way, yeah.
Okay, great, fantastic, good job.
One of the ones that we had on our list was love, and we think that the Millennium Goals, we think all of them kind of link in with love. Because if you have love, then you can, like, achieve anything that you want to, because that's what I think anyway.
Well, your connections. Tell me about your connection. When you talk about oxygen?
Oxygen? Yeah.
Okay, is connected with which Millennium Goal?
Clean up the environment.
Okay, what else do you have there?
We got shelter, which could reduce poverty and people living on the streets.
Okay.
And then the family, we wrote family, and that could ensure safe and healthy motherhood.
Okay.
And the equal chances for girls and women through the family.
Okay. And what is, this one is?
Clean water.
Okay.
Could fight infectious diseases.
Okay, great. The list of the Millennium Goals.
Mm-hmm.
Where do you think that
list
come from?
India.
India
area.
India? Like, right.
None of that's to do with us.
No way.
It doesn't have to do anything with you.
In third world countries.
Okay. Who made that list? Any ideas?
Oxfam. People.
Sorry?
It's a lot.
They're like, he's the only one who is right. Well, first of all, that list, a declaration that all the governments that are part of the United Nations agree. So it's not for Africa, it's not for India, it's not for Colombia, no, it's for the entire world. It's a declaration, it's a commitment that all the governments, including the UK government, agree to say, well, we are going to contribute to reduce poverty. And then in 2000, all the very important people in the world met in the UN Assembly, and they said, well, we all agree that we need to do something to reduce poverty in a global level. Do you think that in the UK there is poverty?
Yeah.
Some bits. The importance of the Millennium Goals Declaration, the government set the targets of how to reduce poverty by 2015. The declaration was signed in 2000, and not many progress has been done at that level. And then I will explain where after the break. But I want you to look at the list, and I want you to think very, very, very quickly how you could make a poster. She's going to do something special.
I'm going to sing for you one of the traditional folk songs in Uganda. And at the same time, we're going to learn a very short traditional folk song. It's a lullaby. It will be so easy. Don't worry about it. So the traditional folk song I'm going to choose is actually a cattle keeping song. Do you know cattle keeping?
No.
Okay. Let me start from the very beginning. In Uganda, most of the people depend on agriculture and cattle keeping. So cattle keeping is like someone like Devi may have maybe hundreds of cows. So what Devi can do is to ask some men and women to take care of those cows. That's cattle keeping. So we do a lot of that, and people can be able to, you know, pay school fees for their children, be able to buy food, buy clothing, mention it. So the song I'm gonna sing is a cattle keeping song called Zajumera. It is very easy and very relaxing song. It means that the cattle keepers composed it in praise of their beautiful cows. And one thing that the Ugandan cows have that is different from any other cows I've seen, that they have very long horns. So when either of you get a chance to visit East Africa, you will see those cows. So so that was the cattle keeping song. We're gonna learn a very simple traditional lullaby. Some of you have young brothers and sisters, cousins and neighbor babies. Please stick the song in your heads. You may sing it when you get them. So would you repeat after me? Ngayaya.
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 Muguma wange.
Muguma wange.
Muguma wange. Ngayaya ngayaya mukuma wange ngayaya ngayaya mukuma wange ngayaya ayaya mukuma wange ngayaya ngayaya mukuma wange ngayaya ngayaya mukuma wange ngayaya ngayaya mukuma wange. Can we take it together slowly first? 1, 2, 3. We go. Ngaya yanga yaya mukuma wange ngaya yanga yaya mukuma wange ngaya yanga yaya mukuma wange ngaya yanga yaya mukuma wange. Can we hear only the girls? 1, 2, 3 Girls, away. Betray me, please. Ngaya yanga yaya mukuma wange. Ngaya yanga yaya mukuma. Okay, boys, please show those girls that you can sing better. Boys, are you ready?
Yes.
1, 2, 3. Ngaya yanga yaya mukuma wange. Ngaya yanga yaya mukuma wange. Ngaya yanga.
Well, now we're going to think about how we spend our money.
You guys would come up with a great list of your own of the things that you spend your money on. So what I want to do now is like a wish list of the things that you think you need to get through a week. And we're going to write them down, okay? So who wants to start it off for 10? Who's going to give me something they think they need every day?
Clothes.
Clothes.
Do you buy them every
day? How much do you spend on clothes a week? Ballpark figure. How much? 20 quid. You spent £3.60 to get you through school?
Yep.
Right, okay. Anyone else spend any money on school today? Just to get through school?
Yeah, yes. Just a pound for masks.
No. I spent about £1.60.
On?
This and chewing gum.
Water and chewing gum, right? Water and chewing gum. How much did you say, £1.60?
Yeah.
Right, okay, anything else? Come on, what else would you spend your money on each week?
Sweets?
Yeah.
Right, sweets, how much?
About a pound a day.
A pound a day?
Yeah.
That's, is that a fiver a week or 7 quid? I'm not sure. Are we doing like Monday to Friday or all week? So that's seven quid in sweets. Okay? Yeah.
From the boxing gym?
Yeah. Boxing gym? How much do you spend in fees? How many times you go a week?
About five.
How much? Who's good at maths? How much is one?
£7.50.
Thank you very much. £7.50 on boxing fees, right? Okay. Something else. What else do you use every day?
Money for your phone.
Awesome. Text or top ups. How much do you reckon you spend on your phone?
A week, about tenner.
A tenner a week.
Yep.
Right. Anything else? Training for hours. Come on. What else?
What spend on makeup?
£17 a month. £17 a month.
Yeah. And that's for 20. Foundation, bronzer, and mascara. Okay.
And moisturiser. We're going to write a family shopping list. So, what do you include in a family shopping list for a week?
Bread, milk, crisps, chicken,
steak,
meat, waffles,
hair wash, conditioner,
soap, yes,
Chardel,
shampoo, yeah. Conditioner.
Sardell.
Perfume.
Tattoo shop. I'm
like. Deodorant. Perfume.
Body spray.
Yogurt.
Bradley.
Dog food. And a child did it right.
McDonald's.
Tetron. For your mom.
Milk. Orange juice. Coke. Fresh Sprite.
Orange juice. Tea bags.
Meat. Vegetables. Ice cream?
Pancakes?
We could have just lollipops.
Ice lollipops.
Nutella.
Jam.
Nutella.
Butter.
Jam. Butter.
Cereal. Contact lenses.
Strawberries. Grapes. Strawberries and cream.
We'll put fruit down.
Chocolate.
Okay.
Washing powder.
Good one, washing powder.
What do you think would make your life comfortable?
Something for sandwiches.
Toilet roll.
Shampoo.
iTunes. iTunes voucher.
Toilet.
Not right.
Sideways. 200 a week. Okay, what about here? What do you have? You have.
That's not. It would not be 80 quid.
Bread, milk, butter, crisps, chocolate, vegetables, sweets, pancakes, soft drinks, meat. Ready meals, noodles, waffles?
Yeah,
waffles. Okay. Clothes, biscuit, shampoo, conditioner, toothpaste, shower hair, deodorant, soap, body spray. Okay. Cake mix, ice cream, dessert, spice, sauces, cereal, pasta. Okay. How much cost this?
About 100 quid.
Okay. How much cost a load of bread?
About a pound.
About a pound? Okay.
$1.90.
Okay. You know what? I'm going to give you some money. Give you symbolically £2.50 per a day. So multiply that for 5 days to do the shopping list. So you have to choose the essentials.
£12.50.
That's just a big roller, isn't it?
£2.
Do I have to do a task?
That's still 12
a day, okay?
So 10 glasses.
I'm going to give you.
Just put Tesco's value in for them.
Well, I'm going to give you £1.50 a day.
Yeah, £1.50?
Yes. And I'm going to give you a day 50p.
What?
David's dead.
So, I want that in 5 minutes, very, very, very quickly, you make a shopping list with the budget that you have, okay?
Water is.
So how much is a loaf of bread?
Oh, you get water, you're
okay.
Fine world.
No, because that's actually quite expensive.
Well, how
first of all, if you want more money, go to ATM.
Tesco value.
How much is a loaf of bread then?
This. How much is a loaf of bread?
A cheap one.
You get any pay in Tesco's for bread? Okay, what's the next thing on your list then?
Water?
No, you should get that from Taps.
Yeah, but you'd need money to run the water.
No.
Just your shop list.
Alright,
okay. Okay, so you've 170 left.
Beans. You need like chicken and stuff like meals.
Bread.
Chicken,
no,
because Tesco's.
Beans, because bread and beans.
You can eat everything.
It's really going to fill you
up. Bread and beans.
What about rice or pasta?
Yeah, pasta fills up.
Alright, so bag of rice. Or a kilogram of rice.
What did you say?
Beans. Bread and beans.
Do you think that it is impossible to live with that money?
No.
Yes. No, oh, people do.
Well,
you starve you.
Go back to the
I lived on bread and right, beans.
Alright, so just write pasta and water.
Give you a pound budget anyway, so 180. So 70p left.
Pasta would probably be 70p.
Yeah.
So just that's it then? That's our shop list done?
That's like one day's worth. That's only 20.
You can eat that every day.
Yeah, but we're oh, water comes from the tap.
Well, she so gave us 2 quid, is it?
2.50.
Oh, 2.50. I thought it was 2 quid. That's what it
was. Wow. Well, we kind of.
You need
to hold spend like a fiver. Bread, rice, and pasta.
Uh huh.
That's about it.
But if I you have enough for a week?
Probably not. We need to. We were still thinking.
Okay.
Ration ourselves.
So how much is this?
That's a fiver.
2 loaves of bread, uh-huh. 2 kilos of rice, and 2...
Pasta, okay. What about milk? It's not
that's what we're still going for.
Okay. Wait, what happened? You have 350 pounds
a week.
Okay, tell me how you're going to spend that
money.
Right. Well, the bread's 50p, Tesco's 80p. Yeah. That's 11.59 whenever it's introduced.
Uh-huh. Yes.
Yep.
Do you know how many people in the world live with less than 50p?
More than one.
They must have 1p shops or something.
More than one what?
No. Let's talk about billions, millions, hundreds, thousands.
I'd say at least 20%.
Okay. How many people live
Silencio.
On less than 50p? A day.
20 million.
I'd say. No, I'd be like 4 billion because
people who live in hostels. Is this all over the world?
No.
Yes, but things are cheaper over there.
He's missing.
Half a million.
45 million.
Half of the world.
Yeah.
Give me a number. I need a number.
3 billion.
Okay.
4 billion.
Okay.
4 billion.
I'm going to give you the official figure, and it's 1.2 billion people live with less than 50p a day. I'm going to give you some numbers. You were living with 250 a day, no?
Yes.
Yeah.
I'm going to tell you what a family in Tanzania buy with 250. They buy for a day tomatoes, onion, vegetables, no meat. This is for a day. This is the meat for a day. This is what they can spend with that money. In Peru, 250 would buy food for a family for 1 kilo of chicken, 2 kilos of potatoes, and enough bread for breakfast and an evening meal.
Yeah, you would never be able to get any of that over here for 250 a day.
What do you think?
No comment.
But to be fair, it's like the same basis, because if you have more money and everything's more expensive, it's like having not enough money, but everything being cheap. Poverty is hunger. Poverty is a lack of shelter. Poverty is being sick and not being able to see a doctor. Poverty is not having access to school and not knowing how to read. Poverty is not having a job. Is fear for the future. Poverty is powerlessness, lack of representation or freedom by the World Bank.
Okay, do you think that people in poor countries are unhappy?
Or unhappy, okay. Did you say?
Unhappy.
Yeah?
Because if they don't know what their friends what are like, then.
So they're using that poverty is always related with money.
No, not always.
No. It
could be love.
Can be what?
It could be like friends and family. Okay. If you have friends and family, you might not be.
Exactly. Think for only 5 minutes on a very, very short definition about poverty.
Poverty is not having access to the essentials in life.
No, having access to essentials of life. The Millennium Development Goal 1 is to eradicate extreme poverty and hunger. And the target is to try to reduce in 500 million the people who is poor or people who lives in extreme poverty. Poverty is the people who live with the income of the national income. The comparison, for example, if the UK income for a person is, let's say, 50p a day, and you live with 4p, then you are poor. But if you live with 2p, then you are living in extreme poverty. It's more or less a comparison. Okay? So this is the Millennium Goal number one. I mean, if, when I give money to a charity or an organization that promote or develop projects in the developing countries, what I am doing? Providing what? What is the magic word there? Is aid, help, exactly. This afternoon, we invited someone from Worldwide Concern, and she's going to talk about the role of her organization.
Yes, I'm Claire, and I work at Concern Worldwide, and we are an international development agency. And I think over the last, I think this morning certainly, and last week we've been talking about poverty and things like that. And our main aim is to eradicate poverty and also look at the reasons why poverty exists and campaign against those reasons. We're best known in our fight against hunger. We are very one of the best agencies in the world at looking at nutrition and seeing, understanding the reasons why some people are going hungry and what we can do to ensure that that just doesn't happen in our world today. I'm a fundraiser there, so my main job is to try and get some money in, because obviously the work that we're doing needs to be funded. So I am lucky enough and privileged enough to work with lots of our community groups. We have great people all over Northern Ireland that raise money for us on an annual basis. And so I'm very privileged and lucky to go out and work with them and organise events, etc., to try and get the money in. And they're very dedicated also as well to the whole eradication of poverty. So it's great to see. It's great to be here in the school as well, actually, and see lots of young faces who are, you know, obviously interested in this topic too. So thank you very much.
How much does Concern Worldwide a year make a year?
That's a very good question. And it does depend, obviously, year on year. Like last year, for instance, we raised over £10 million. It depends on what happens. Like last year, with the emergencies, with Haiti emergency, and then there were floods in Pakistan and after the Haiti earthquake, and people are very good at responding because obviously there's lots of media coverage, so people can understand what's happening in another country very easily and very clearly, and that obviously helps them to raise money. Other years will obviously be different, and now, given the global economy at the moment, I mean, everybody's very aware that we're in global recession, so the money would probably be less and less, but on average, like last year was definitely over 10 million. And then we have Concern UK, which is the Belfast and London offices. We have Concern, our main headquarters are in Dublin in Ireland. And we also have Concern US, and there's offices in New York and Chicago. So between all the different fundraising, there'll be different monies raised, but for Concern UK, it was 10 million.
If I put 50p into a charity box, whenever that's all collected up, do the government take a percentage of that?
No, they don't. Very clear answer, no they don't. The best thing, whenever you give 50p to a charity box, every charity is going to be different, so I can obviously only speak for Concern, but 88% of it is going to go in directly into our work overseas. So we always say, you know, it's 88p in every pound, so obviously 44p out of your 50p would go directly overseas. That's because we actually work very hard to make sure that that's the case.
Other charities, of course, will be different than that, you know, because obviously you have to pay fundraising wages and campaigning costs, etc., etc. One of the good things, though, of course, is say you give money to a charity and then you gift aid it. There's where you need to be working and paying tax. But the government actually has a scheme where they will give us money then on the money that you've given us. So basically then if you give a pound, the government, and you gift aid it and you let us know that it's gift aided through a government scheme, we can get another 28p on your pound. So rather than the government taking any money, the government actually has a scheme by which we can get more money from them. But then it definitely depends on the charity as to how much then of your 50p is going to go into the programmes.
You're saying that 88% of the money goes to the charity, or is the other 22% go?
The rest of it goes to home costs and running, things like the wages of the staff, running, like having to pay rent, etc., for offices. Obviously, you know, we have a few campaigns throughout the year, like the Concern Fast, for instance, would be a very big campaign for us. And in order for people to know about it, you need to have pamphlets and leaflets and posters, and there's costs attached to all that. So that's the rest of the money goes into fundraising, into governance, into campaigning. There's no money doesn't come back if you do petitions, etc., to the government. Again, there's money, you know, incurred and in running those campaigns. But we have a very good policy in the fact that everything that's done, you have to get a very strong, what you call an ROI, which is a return on your investment. So every, you know, if you put in a certain amount of money, you need to be getting X amount of money back. But we're happy as long as we know that, you know, if you're campaigning and the money's going to a government, you know, to petition the government in some way, at least we know that that's been spent in a very good way.
And the 12% covers all your costs? Yeah,
yeah, it does. I mean, it can fluctuate. And it's at the minute it's 88p. A couple of years ago it might have been 89p. Last year, 2 years ago actually, it was 87p. So it also depends on, I mean, there's lots of different variables. It can depend on currency exchanges and how much money you get, because a lot of our work is done in US dollars, because a lot of things that happen in the world and a lot of the trade is obviously done in US dollars. So a lot of our currency can, you know, changes. You know, if you're buying rice, etc., in an African country, obviously there's can be fluctuation in food prices, and that's all taken into account. So, but on average, yes, we try very hard, and it would be 88p, and then the 12p covers everything else. Yeah.
How did you get involved in Concern Worldwide?
I always wanted to work for a development agency because it's something I believe very strongly in. You know, I think that we all have a responsibility. Everyone as a global citizen has a responsibility and is accountable for what's happening in our world. So I always wanted to work in a development agency. Although in saying that, my background is in marketing. I went to university and I studied marketing and business, and I did work in a corporate company for 6 years. Although at the time I also, you know, kept up to date with what was happening. And then I saw the opportunity. There was, you know, I always just kept my eye open for job opportunities, and I saw one with Concern and was lucky enough, just applied for it and was lucky enough to get it. So, but it's very important as well. I had taken a few years out in between and travelled. You know, I was lucky enough to be able to travel extensively and, you know, just got to see different things that was happening in the world. And I worked in South America for a few years for different local charities there, and got experience with how the charity world works. And then when I came back home to Northern Ireland, I was lucky that there was the opening. I just want to say, you know, it's a very interesting place, a very interesting type of work. And I think, you know, you all have the chance now, obviously when you're younger, to like look at volunteer opportunities and just sort of see how you can help in things like that. And, you know, be aware of obviously the impact that your actions can have, you know, in the world, and just sort of keep an eye out. And then I'd recommend the development sector for anybody to work in. You don't get the best pay now, I'll tell you that. You definitely, if you want big bucks, go to somewhere else, but it's definitely worth it.
How do you decide like who deserves the money? Like, because obviously there's loads of people wanting it.
Very good question. And
again, different charities decide in different ways, and I'll just speak for concern. The UN have what they call the Human Development Index, and they work out who the very poorest countries in the world are, and it's through, they look at the wealth of the country, the education, whether or not people are, you know, the levels of literacy, how long people go to school. They look at life expectancy rates, and then there's like a formula where they work out who the poorest people in the world are and which countries are the poorest and concern, and then they call it the Human Development Index, and they basically rank every country in the world on that index. And what concern day is we work in the poorest, most remote places in the world. So whenever we look at where we're going to work, we only ever work in the bottom 40 of the UN's Human Development Index, because they're the poorest countries in the world. And then we also have to look at, we use our own criteria to look at who's the most vulnerable, which countries are the most fragile, where there's conflict, and where basically the people are the most vulnerable. And then that's all taken into consideration. And then we decide, right, that's, you know, one of the countries that we will work in. And oftentimes as well, we also enter a country after a big emergency. For instance, there, we had been working in Haiti before, but I'm sure you all remember the Haiti earthquake that happened in January last year. If something like that happens in the world and there's an emergency like that, we'll automatically go to respond to that, because people need rapid relief, and we have teams of experts that know how to do that. And then we'd also look at staying in that country, because obviously when there's been an emergency like that, things don't get better overnight. And so what we'd do is we would look at, you know, whether or not we'd stay and look at long-term development to help sort of help the people get back on their feet and just get up and running again. So that might be another reason why we would enter a country, but definitely normally it's because they're the most fragile, most vulnerable, and definitely poorest countries in the world.
Have you personally ever been to any of the countries that you've given money to?
I haven't, but not for concern worldwide, but because to be honest, I'd love to go, but there's not real reason yet for me to go, because it would cost X amount of money for me to be there, and I sort of don't need that highlighted to me, because I know that the work that we're doing is very good, and I'm lucky enough that I get to meet on a regular basis the people that do work overseas. I do have a good knowledge of poverty though, because when I was working in Latin America, I worked for different organisations and we dealt with extreme poverty there. So my background and my knowledge of poverty is good, but I actually haven't been in any of the countries that Concern works in at the minute.
Have Concern ever worked with any other charity to help the country?
Absolutely, 100%. I think you've been talking about the Millennium Development Goals. And actually, number 8 of the Millennium Development Goals is about working together and interdependence and forming partnerships, etc. And as part of that, Concern is actually part of a group called Allegiance 2015. And it's 7 different international development agencies across Europe who've got together just to make sure, just to kind of, you know, have strength in numbers and strength in working together and being interdependent. Just to see what we can do about making sure that the Millennium Development Goals are, if not achieved, certainly kept on track and kept part of, you know, on top of the agenda. So from a whole campaigning and political point of view, we absolutely advocate working with other NGOs as well. And in an emergency context, we also work with NGOs in the countries, on the ground, as we say. I'll use Haiti as an example again, just because I've mentioned it before, but obviously when you want to make a difference somewhere, there's strength in numbers, and it doesn't make sense for lots of different people doing the same type of work. So what happens is the UN actually get together and they look at all the NGOs that have come in to help, and they organise what you call clusters. So Concern would be on a certain cluster with another international development agency. So for example, say there's a cluster that's dealing specifically with shelter,
or we're working with what we call WATSAN, which is water and sanitation. So working on making sure that people have access to clean water and making sure that there's proper sanitation for people to go, you know, to get washed or go to the toilet and things like that. And the best way to achieve results is actually to work together and make sure that we're just being efficient and effective, because we also have a responsibility to the people in Haiti, for instance, where they need our help, and to the people that give us money. So we want to make sure that we're working at the very best of our ability and to a good capacity. So it's just, it's more efficient and more effective to make sure that we do work together. So yeah, absolutely.
How long have you worked for Concern?
For about 3.5 years now.
How much money did Concern Worldwide actually give Haiti?
Ooh, there's a good question.
Or what about all together, all the charities give the Haiti?
Do you know, I don't know actually. I probably should know, and I certainly probably knew it more at the time. Concern altogether, across all of the Concern offices, I think it was in around 8 million. And some of it, a lot of it, I think it was like 44% of it then is to be spent this year, and 66% of it was spent last year.
Do you know what that actually went towards?
I do. I've got it broken down, but I can't remember offhand. But it would have gone into...
obviously food, water and shelter. And
yeah,
stuff.
One of our main things would have been shelter. We have what we call a program of shelter where people get automatic help in a temporary shelter, and then it moves up to what you call a transitional shelter. So people would have had, say, tarpaulins and things like that to help them out at the start, and then you moved on and built a proper shelter from wood and concrete and things like that so that it would last for a little bit longer. And I know certainly a lot of our money would have gone to the shelter. And, yeah, naturally water and sanitation, because they're huge needs. I'll tell you what I can do is, like, I'll send an Aaron something, a wee breakdown, so that the next time you get together, you can have a look and see, and I'll give you a proper breakdown as to how the money was spent.
I want to know, how can you ensure when you are over in countries that need the help, how can you ensure that the right people get the stuff that they need and the financial resources that they need? I did a lot of charity work when I was younger. I went to India as part of that, and we ended up, as well as being there on the ground, we ended up giving we raised money and given cash, and unfortunately we were very concerned about what actually happened to that money afterwards, to make sure that it went for, or was spent in the right things, and went to the right people. How do you ensure that? Like, we were only 18 at the time, so we couldn't actually really do an awful lot. How do you as an organisation?
I mean, it's one of the biggest questions, and how do you know that your money is going to the right place? And I guess the answer is probably quite a complex one, but at the same time, an NGO like Concern, we have responsibility to ensure that it does, and there's lots of measures put in place to make sure that everything is transparent and that we're held accountable. I guess just some of the things that we would do is we would talk to the people in the communities firstly before we would do anything, and find out who exactly needs the money, what's happening in the community. And then we take it from there. But we also would have to work alongside different ministries and governments, and just to kind of suss it all out and just see how things work in country. We've a few different measures. Darren, you probably would be good at answering this one too. But we've a few different measures in place, like things like you do want to ensure that corruption doesn't happen, and you do want to ensure that the correct people are getting help. So. We would have different bits and pieces of legislation and policy to ensure that, we would fight.
And sometimes, just very quickly, because we're just going to finish here, the money's probably going to places where you don't think it should go, but actually it is benefiting in a longer term. I mean, I went to Romania, and people were concerned that the soldiers at the border were getting some prams and some baby clothes. I said, should be going to the people. Unaware that the soldiers were paid far less than any KFC worker or McDonald's worker in Romania. They were paid the bottom of the scale. So they were in extreme poverty, and people were thinking because they're in a soldier uniform, they were rich. They weren't at all. And actually those prams of children were actually going to families which really, really needed it. So sometimes what you see visually is not always the case, So, but we're going to have to leave it there. So a good Claire round of applause.
say that you can change the world. Can you?
Yes.
How?
Get money.
Get money. Mm? This is one thing that you could do, yes? What else you can do?
Go over to the country and help.
Sorry?
Go over to the country and help.
Okay, what else you can do?
Buy fair trade products.
Spread the word.
Fair trade products, okay, what else?
Spread the word.
And how do you do that?
TV.
Tell others on radio, campaign.
Okay, okay. I have some facts here. Cannot remember all of them. So we say that when we give money to a charity or a NGO, it's because we believe that they are going to help somewhere in the world. Do you think that there are other ways that we can help? No? You say fair trade products. Who said fair trade? Buying fair. What is fair trade products?
When you buy products,
cut out the middleman.
Yeah, you pretty much cut out the middleman.
Uh huh.
It's hard to describe it. The majority of the money goes to the farmer.
The farmer gets more money from the process.
Yeah, instead of having to pay.
Okay.
Someone else takes
it. Okay, well, I'm going to explain what is the fair trade. The fair trade works in the... Well, the idea is that you have the producer, you have like a chain of traders. People who buy products and resell the products. Well, in the fair trade principle, the idea is that the farmer joins a cooperative and the cooperative sells the produce directly to the distributors. So there are not many intermediaries. There are not many people in the middle, because everybody who is in the middle between the farmer and the distributor, I mean the main distributor who sells the produce to other supermarkets and all of this, everybody gets money. And that makes the prices increase. But what happened is that for the farmer, he's at the end of the chain. He's at the end or at the beginning, whatever you see it. So they will get less profits if there are so many people or intermediaries. And this is how fair trade works, through cooperatives and small corporations in the countries. So what else we can do? Well, I'm going to give you an idea. After looking at the poster, we're going to make a song that is going to change the world. To do the song, we're going to have the support of Donna, Darren, Victor, Kanesh, and Dave. They are musicians, so they will help you to create a song. It doesn't have to be a song. It can be a rap, it can be a poem, it can be something like that. What do you think? It's a good idea or?
We are the change makers. Change makers we shall be.
We hope you have enjoyed it.
We are the change makers. Let's end poverty.
We are the change makers. Change makers we shall be.
We hope you have enjoyed it.
Now it's time for the family. We are the change makers.
Poverty for all, but freedom's the exception. Price of freedom is worth it to me. Fighting a revolution, fighting for the human, fighting for you and for me.
Poverty for all, but freedom's the exception. Price of freedom is worth it to me. Fighting revolution, fighting for the human, fighting for you and for me.
Poverty for all, but freedom's the exception. The price of freedom is worth it to me. Fighting revolution, fighting for the human, fighting for you and for me.
Poverty for all, freedom's the exception. The price of freedom is worth it to me. Fighting the revolution, fighting for the human, fighting for you and for me.
You're listening to Dimensions Project from Priory College. A global education skills project developed and managed by Beyond Skin in partnership with Concern Worldwide. Funded by the Department for International Development. For more information about the project, visit www.beyondskinglobal.org.
Planet.